Today I'm going to talk to you about the Border Terrier. The Border Terrier is of old, and also the modern interpretations thereof. So the Border Terrier is a fell type of terrier, which means it is able to hold its own. It's like a miniature strong dog. So a strong dog type of terrier that goes below ground and then catches the quarry. And the quarry, in case of the Border Terrier, were especially like the most fell terriers, foxes. Also some occasional badger, but especially the fox. So what you see here is not a Border Terrier. This is another fell type of terrier, a black dog, a smooth-coated fell terrier, also known as a Bettedale. It's 11 months old. But all those fell terriers have similar traits. So what does it mean? They're all strong dogs, which are working silent and capable to engage and fight with quarry instead of just barking at it and teasing and taunting it. So the Border Terrier is more of a rough-coated fell type of terrier, which has a long past of a working dog and is currently being used as a family pet and show dog. The thing about the Border Terrier is that it hasn't changed that much over time, they say. But if you look at the old pictures of the original Border Terriers, then you see a dog that closer resembles this type of dog. So this black smooth-coated fell terrier. But you also have them in a rougher coat, and it would be even more interesting to compare than the modern day Border Terrier. So what changed? The nose of the modern, more show type variant of Border Terrier became shorter, and also they stopped using the Border Terrier as the go-to terrier for earthworm. That does not mean there are not working Border Terriers anymore. There are. Some of them are really good. And also the Border Terrier has contributed to the modern fell terrier type. For example, also in the Bettedale, which is now the king of earth terriers, a Border Terrier was added. So that gives you an indication of Border Terrier in history, current Border Terrier, but also what it did for the current working breed. So the Border Terrier is often a little bit like a wheaten colored, darker colors are often found in the face, on the muzzle, but also around the back area. The coat is rough, that means it is not that rough as compared to the rough coated Bettedale Terrier. It's more like a rough, broken coat. And yeah, the coat is very handy because it can help against brushes and all the other stuff in working without weighing the dog down if the conditions are more wet. So why did the Border Terrier change? Because of people. People wanted to get the looks, the form, before the function. And then they went on exaggerating. But that doesn't mean that a current day and age Border Terrier is a bad dog. I think it's a very good dog. Also thought about getting one of a working strain. Working strains of Border Terriers are now not easy to find. And also there are other reasons that I went with the black smooth-coated Fell Terrier Patterdale as is. But I really like the Border Terrier. So what did they change then if form was dictated over function? If you look at the Border Terrier, it's still a very capable dog. If you look at the anatomy, if you compare it, for example, to this Fell type of terrier, you see that the back of the Patterdale Terrier has more length to it, and the other difference are not that big. As I mentioned, the modern day Border Terrier has a little bit shorter snout. So if you look at the spiky at the head of this one, this is an 11 month old Patterdale Terrier, then you see that the nose length is the same length as the rest of the skull, or even a little bit shorter, but with the Border Terrier it's often a lot shorter. And why did they do that? The show people wanted to have a dog with the head of an otter. And the head of an otter is very sturdy, so they decreased the length of the muzzle. And then, with that coat type that was already present in the Border Terrier, so that broken, rougher coat, it really had the appearance of an otter dog in the head. The thing is, a little bit shorter nose doesn't have that many detrimental effects. If you've got a very short nose, you get troubles, but the Border Terrier is still a good, capable size of nose. And also in, for example, game-bred dogs, sometimes you see strains which have shorter muzzles, and often those dogs have a very funny bite. So also, to hunt low, if you have a little bit shorter nose, it doesn't need to be detrimental. It just gives you a little less air, and it removes a little bit of space between the nose of the dog and the eyes, for example. So, in other words, a prey, for example, a fox, when it is hit by a shorter-nosed dog, it can easier access or damage the eyes as compared to a little bit longer muzzled dog. But then again, if you look at the working strains of Border Terrier, those can be added, for example, to a Patterdale or another Tefal type of dog, and sometimes they did it, and you get a little bit more the bully heads in it. And some of those were really good workers. You must not forget that if you cross in a different breed, you often get a little bit more heterosis, especially for those that breed dogs with a very strong instinct, temperament, gameness. They often breed very tight, and then it's good that you have an out, so you can outcross to another breed that's often tight bred, but from a different stock. And for that example, a Border Terrier of working strains is not a bad choice to introduce to your breeding program. If your breeding program is running very tight, or you don't have access to another good hunting dog. Also, breeding a little bit of German Jagd Terrier could not be a bad case if you want a dog that's more of a mixed type, and also more a baying, barking type of dog instead of just engaging. The Border Terrier is also a very engaging dog, so if you have one of working stock that has the courage, it will not bark that much, but will just go to the quarry and attack it and hold it, or try to hold it as good as it can. If you introduce those Border Terriers to a Patterdale stock, you can get a strong head, and if that's something that you like, feel free to do so. And people have done it, of course. But it's not a bad choice. The other way around is also not a bad choice. To breed in Patterdale into Border Terrier to get some more foundation blood. And then, for example, if you still like the Border Terrier type, there's also a Patterdale type that has a broken coat. You could introduce that so that you, the, you keep the wiry broken coat. Or you could even breed a smooth-coated Border Terrier type of dog. If you breed them to, for example, Patterdales with a short coat, and keep on with breeding that program. For me, I like the shorter coat better. I think the... Hey! The coat of the Border Terrier is very functional, so it might be the best way to approach it if you're on a coat that doesn't get very much filled in it, doesn't weigh the dog down if it gets wet too much, and also offers the protection. But the thing is, for example, the smooth coated Patterdale has also a very dense coat that you just presses the dirt out of it. And also offers protection because Patterdales have a very thick skin. And there's a dense undercoat that's not that dense, but helps to get it get the protection up to a higher level. And also one should remember that the Patterdale coat will, like all dog breeds, but the Patterdale coat can also be changing depending on the conditions you work in. So for example, if the dog is kept outside, you will get a thicker coat than a dog kept inside. A lot of hunting dogs are kept outside. And then your coat can also be stronger, more of an undercoat present. So that's a thing to take into consideration. I like this coat more than the Border Terrier coat. It's also very easy to dry. Almost no fuss, so that's for me the reason why I went with a Patterdale instead of a Border Terrier. I do think Border Terriers are fantastic, one of the best terrier breeds to have. Also, I really like the Lakeland, and Lakeland Border Terrier crosses, for example, are very nice. And the same to Border Terrier Patterdale crosses. I've seen a few now, and they look to have a very strong head, which I like, a little bit more bulldog head, without the drawbacks of a real bulldog head. So even a Border Terrier has a good amount of breathing space, and you keep a strong head with that. For me, this head type is, strong enough, but I know a friend of mine who really prefers a little bit of the woody type of head. So as woody as possible without losing functionality. If you have benefits for a little bit shorter snouts in strength, then you could lose a little bit of functionality, but never those exaggerated features that you see in just show dogs. Also, the Border Terrier is a dog that can fit a lot of lifestyles. For example, as you compare it to the Patterdale Terrier, it's even more relaxed. Also, if you looking for a very relaxed type of dog, this could be the choice. Oi, oi. So just have this in mind if you were looking for a small sturdy terrier that is working for you as it should, either being a nice reliable, quite healthy pet that's also active but is not that nervous as compared to, for example, the Russell or a normal fox terrier type of dogs. Also the yacht terrier is very alert, always busy. Some people we get some ticks from that, because they just don't stop. And it's nice to have a dog that is both very active and also can be very tranquil and relaxed if needed, instead of just a hyper dog all the day long. So I just want to show you some things and also show you this dog as a comparable, like a modern interpretation of the Border Terriers of old. And I invite you to look up the old pictures of the Border Terrier and see the resemblance in the snout and other parts as compared to other fell type terriers. For example, this Patterdale Terrier, which has a very strong head as well, but a little bit more breathing space, a longer back as compared to the modern day Border Terrier. And is, I must say, a little bit more active as compared to the Border Terrier of these days. And I really like to point out that some breeders are recreating or still caressing their hunting strain of Border Terriers, which is fantastic, really fantastic. I would love to see the Border Terrier back to the glory it had. One should not be attached too much to one breed or the romantic sense about it, but I really like it when people try to get the dogs in a better shape and to better health. So looking forward to more of that. He's now hunting, I think, for mice or some other stuff. They're getting young again, eh? And then perhaps they are just looking around. Also on this sunny day. So have a nice day.